So, Whitney, how will I know?
Mm-hmm.
What can you say about Whitney Houston that hasn't been said? One of the most incredible artists in the history of mankind. I mean, nobody sang or will ever sing like Whitney Houston. I mean, growing up and hearing her stuff, I was blown away. And this album, it has the ballads, mm-hmm. and it has the R&B, mm-hmm. but they needed that pop song, you know, that really popped, take her to radio and take it to all generations. And that's exactly what it did.
Thank you.
Tell me what you remember about starting out, because you were working on some stuff with Aretha when you got called to do How Will I Know.
Yes.
Tell me about how that came together.
I was cutting the Freeway of Love, Who's Zooming Who, at the Automat Studios in San Francisco for Aretha, and really focused.
Yeah.
Because I knew that had to be right. And I got a phone call from Jerry Griffith from Arista Records.
Yep.
And Jerry said, I really want you to work on a song for Whitney Houston. I said, Jerry, I don't have time. I'm really right in the middle of making this Aretha record. And he knew that. But he said, but you don't want to sleep on this because she'll be a big artist. I go, well, what? You know?
Yeah.
He is Sissy Houston's daughter. I go, oh, okay, I know Sissy Houston because she sang my first album, Garden Love Life.
Yeah.
I said, okay. He said, let me send you an idea of a song we got for her. I said, okay. And then a few days later, I got a song called How Will I Know? It was a chorus.
Yeah.
But there was no verse.
Wasn't it the demo that Shannon Rubicon did?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And George
right,
Merrill.
That's right.
Yeah.
They're geniuses, man.
Yeah.
And I said, there's a strong chorus, but there's no verse.
Yeah.
So I said, you know, I mean, I'd love to work, but I had to rewrite the song, if that's the case, and I have to make time to do that. He said, well, let me call the writers back, Shannon and George, and see how they feel about that. And it was like magic, boom, go ahead and do it. I said, okay. So I just stopped what I was doing for the minute, went to the piano, banged out. Like that, just a sketch, yeah. You know? And then gave it to the cats, George and Shannon, and they wrote the lyric, sent it back. I then cut the track with Randy and Corrado, the same team again.
Yeah.
As you hear it, and I flew to New York on an overnight because they wanted it right away. I met with Whitney in the studio at Media Sound with Michael Barbiero, and she walked in looking like $1 million. Like, you know how she can look. And I was like, whoa, I hadn't seen her. I didn't know. I was like, whoa, you know? So then, you know, after we talked a little minute.
Yeah.
And one thing she had told me on the phone before I got there, she says, don't change the key, keep it high. I said, are you sure it's really, really high? I'm going to put the first, da-da-da, really high. She says, don't change it. I said, okay. So when I got there, I met her. She was so cool. She goes on the mic, the headphones. Okay, let's go for it. I mean, the first take is what you're hearing. She was that flawless. I try to fall, but I'm too shy. Can't speak. Falling in love is so bittersweet. This love is strong. That in tune, that much focus and purpose. And I was like, damn, you just nailed it. She said, I'll do it for you another time, just you have a, you know, a little option. I said, okay. And she did another time. You know what I mean? And I said, well, maybe you want to just come in and listen. So she did. She came and she sat in like one of those chairs you can lean back in. And if you're me, I'm her. And she leans back in the chair looking fine and just staring at me. As it's blurring over the speaker, just staring at me. Oh, man. She's really confident. I said, she's really confident. And she's like, you know, yeah. I sound real good. I said, yeah, you sound real good. She's like, so I was taken by her level of confidence.
Yeah.
It wasn't just some phony ego. Is as great as what you're hearing on that record, but her staring at me. Man, I said, this is a real force. This is a real, because we're used to hearing that kind of sound, you know, that kind of big sound, maybe like a bigger woman. She wasn't. She was like that thick, that thin. Yeah. You know
She's
what I mean?
A model.
She was like tall and very thin. It's like, how can you make that kind of sound?
I know.
But she did.
Jeez.
So then I said, well, your lead vocal's done. Let's get your mom in, maybe you.
Because so your mom sang background vocals.
I said, get him in. Let's come and have him sing some background on this. Let's just do it. She called him up. Boom, they came in. And the mother and two others sang, stood around the mic and sang the backing. And I was like, this is great. Whitney, go out there and join him. Because I missed her voice in it. And she went out there and joined him. That was the sound I wanted. her mom, Whitney, and the two ladies that came with them. That became the backing. And after they sang it, and I stacked them up so it sounded really huge, then they were done. I said, well, let me get my friend in who can bring that Clarence Clemens type sound. I couldn't get Clarence, he was on the road with Bruce. I have a friend named Russell Tubbs. Primate Russell Tubbs. I said, come in and blow that kind of sound for me on the sax. And he did.
Yeah.
And that's the sound you're on the sax. I said, well, while I'm here, if I haven't got a lot of time, I'll just mix it. I said, Michael Barbieri, you're a bad cat. Just help me mix it. So we mixed it. And it was done. It was done, man.
Number one pop record, like number one in the AC charts, number one in the R&B charts. I mean, yeah. Whitney Houston was in a league of her own. And I showed my kids, I'm like, let me show you a pop star.
Okay.
And so I play them, you know, How Will I Know, and So Emotional, all these incredible songs. And they're like, who is that, Dad? Mm-hmm. Who is that? It's Whitney Houston.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't think there'll ever be another.
No, you're right. I mean, you got to imagine, she learned from her mom, who sang backing on almost every major record out of New York,
yeah.
And even toured with Elvis Presley and all that. I mean, all the Aretha Franklin records, as you know, could be Sissy in there somewhere, Dionne Warwick records, as Sissy's in there somewhere. All that education she had.
Yeah.
She's taught Whitney how to be the best.
Yeah.
She said, if you're going to be in the singing game, we're going in the basement, we're going to woodshed, and you're going to become the best singer ever.
Yeah.
And she became that. And don't forget, Dionne Warwick is part of her family. Aretha Franklin's her godmother. I mean, all this royalty is like right there for her. So she's like drawing on that as a little girl.
Yeah.
And I remember I met her, not realizing it was Whitney Houston, on Garden Lovelight. Sissy brought her daughter. She's like 11 years old. She sat in the chair and watched the session. She's a little beautiful little girl. That was Whitney. But I didn't realize that would be the girl I'd be producing in my life. But dang. So
yeah.
She absorbed all that.
Oh, yeah.
So it's God's plan.
Yeah.
It's just God's plan. I mean, you look at a person like Muhammad Ali, right? Muhammad Ali, we call him the greatest boxer of all time. But he learned from watching Sugar Ray Robinson.
Yeah.
And just digesting the best before him.
Yeah.
How to be fast. How to stick and move like that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? How to be a heavyweight and move like a middleweight.
Yeah.
So here's Whitney the same way. Learning how to like move from the chest to the head like Aretha would do, or her mother would teach her, or how Dionne could do. All those tricks, the trades she would learn. How to hold the mic, how to, you know, every little thing about it.
Yeah, all that range,
everything.
All that power, all
how
that beauty.
How to look
beauty.
At the producer and stare the producer down when the sound of how it was flowing over the speaker and dare me to say anything. See what I'm saying? All that, man.
Yeah.
At 19.
I know, jeez.
At 19.
Jeez. Later on, she did that at the Nelson Mandela concert. It was always a special song to her, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And did you ever hear when Sam Smith covered it?
I did.
Yeah.
I say a prayer with every heartbeat. I fall in love whenever we meet.
What'd
you
think? After hearing what she did, I can appreciate other things. But it's nothing like what she did.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you know.
Well, you can't.
I got to tell us about it.
Yeah.
After I've been boxing Muhammad Ali, I mean, everybody else is cool. You know what I mean?